Lieutenant William Holden and Army Air Force personnel in name, rank, serial number, with Walter Houston as Cavalcade commentator on the Cavalcade of America, sponsored by the DuPont Company, maker of better things for better living through chemistry.
Good evening, this is Walter Houston. Cavalcade play, name, rank, serial number, is a story adapted from the Army Air Force's training film, Resisting Enemy Interrogation. Not long ago, I had the opportunity to visit the Army Air Force Motion Picture Unit in Culver City, California, where these films are made. Their AAF film technicians work day and night turning out films to teach men what others have learned from bitter experience. Much of this work is a military secret. Tonight's story about the Nazi Interrogation Center for Captured American Air Force Crews is told for the first time to you. We are privileged to have with us some of the officers and men from the Army Air Force's Motion Picture Unit who helped make this film. The DuPont Company presents Lieutenant William Holden as narrator, Private Kent Smith, Sergeant James T.A., John Beale, Captain Bay, Charles Cannon, and Corporal Arthur Kennedy, in name, rank, serial number, on the Cavalcade of America.
All captured American flyers is extended this invitation. Welcome, gentlemen, to Dulag Luft, Germany. Dulag Luft, where American air crews are brought in for questioning, where Nazi intelligence officers gather bits of information, which, when put together, tell them the story of future Allied operations. That is, if the members of the crew talk, if they reveal anything but name, rank, and serial number.
Yes, the plane crashed yesterday, Captain O'Neill, in northern Italy, a B-99. It captured four of the crew, but they had thoroughly destroyed what was left of their plane.
They have been interrogated, Major von Fink?
Not yet, but I have this preliminary report. One is wounded and is in the hospital. Then we have the pilot, Captain Spencer, a highly intelligent type. A co-pilot, Lieutenant Williams, also intelligent but more easygoing. And the Mason, Master Sergeant, the overconfident type, not quite as clever as you think.
And that is all we have to go on. No personal papers, clothing labels?
Not a scratch. And I'm sure that not one of these men has any complete information concerning activities against us. Here's what information they have we'll get and use. And we'll start with Captain Spencer.
The scene has been laid. The characters are ready. And now the play begins. A play of patience, skill, and cunning.
Cigarette, Captain Spencer?
No, thank you, Major von Bent.
They say a cigarette is good for the nerves, Captain. I'm glad to see you are in excellent shape. I know what a strain these low-level bombing missions are. I had a chat with another B-99 crew from your home base, I believe. Of course it is, isn't it?
My name, sir, is James N. Spencer. My rank is captain. My serial number is 0246931-0.
I just see you misunderstand me. You are not being cross-examined, Captain. Let me assure you, I have no plans that do not conform to the rules of the Geneva Convention. Oh, Herr Mauer.
I beg pardon, Major. I understand the American air crewmen have arrived. When may I see them?
A commander happens to be right here, Herr Mauer. Captain Spencer, this is Herr Mauer, the International Red Cross representative here.
How do you do, sir? Happy to see you safe from sound.
Thank you, sir. We were lucky.
Captain, I have brought you the form, the regular Red Cross form for all American prisoners of war. Mind filling it out? Maybe borrow your pen, Major.
Thanks. This form goes to America?
It's sent to the nearest Red Cross headquarters, then forwarded to our American branch.
Oh. There you are, Herr Mauer.
The other items, Captain, have a finished.
Name, rank, serial number. It's all filled out.
But don't you see, you write your base address here, your unit number here.
Amnesia, Herr Mauer. It's very bad. All I seem to remember is my name, my rank, my serial number.
Aren't you being unduly suspicious, Captain? Those items merely see to it that you receive your mail properly and that your base and your parents are informed you're safe.
Well, that's very odd, sir, because according to the Geneva Convention, just my name, my rank, and my serial number will take care of that. To tell you the truth, I've never seen a form like that before.
Captain, I'm afraid you are what we call the uncooperative type of prisoner.
So, Captain Spencer can be crossed off the list. But tell me, Mr. Fontaine, suppose every one of these men is as alert as Spencer. What then?
Then I shall have wasted my time, Greening. Now, you better get busy with Lieutenant Williams. He's our next man.
Yes, sir. If we can only find out where they came from and what kind of mission they were on.
The other thing's just as important, Captain. Matters, for example, which may have great propaganda value for us. Facts about civilian morale in America. A word about economic conditions there. Just as there is no such thing as an innocent question, there is no such thing as a valueless statement.
Just as there is no such thing as an innocent question, there is no such thing as a valueless statement. Keep this thought in mind as we drop in next on Lieutenant Williams' prison quarters in the west wing of Dulaglu.
Come in.
You are Lieutenant Williams, aren't you?
Yes.
I'm Captain Williams, Lieutenant. I want to check on your hand.
Yes.
Did you any trouble?
It's not serious, Captain. Only a slight burn.
Still, you better have the doctor look at it. I'll take you to his office now. Cigarette? No, go on. They're not poisoned.
Oh, American brand, huh? It's a very thoughtful touch, Captain.
Light? Yes, I'm glad I was thoughtful enough to stock up. You see, I practically grew up on these things.
You practically grew up on the American language, too, didn't you?
Well, I lived in America most of my life. Until the war, that is. You're from Boston, aren't you, Lieutenant?
Well, how did you...
No, nothing mysterious about it. That one accent you can't miss.
Accent? Me? You should hear Cole.
Cole?
Yes, a kid in the hospital. He's from the South. He's got a drawl a mile long.
Oh, really? Where's he from? Alabama?
No, Georgia. Atlanta, Georgia.
Sergeant. Call Dr. Muir at the hospital immediately. Tell him that Sergeant Cole is from Atlanta, Georgia.
Just a slip of the tongue. An insignificant and obviously unimportant bit of information. But enough to start the wheels rolling for German intelligence. Let us follow up this bit of information to the hospital room, where an attractive blonde nurse is gently putting the finishing touches on Sergeant Cole's shoulder dresser.
Now, that is better,
Hurts a little.
It hurts a little, I know. It's a bad structure. Cigarette? Please, it is all right. Take it. I do not know if it is, how do you say, it's your favorite brand, but it is all I could locate.
Well.
I know. The Americans, a cigarette means a great deal to them. In all your stories, there's always so much smoking.
You read American stories?
I used to. As many as I could guess. My favorite, though, it will always be from Winchester.
Well, I reckon I don't know about that.
Oh, of course you do. You only know the other name for it. Gone with the Wind.
Well, how do you like that? You read that?
Uh-huh. The city in the book, what is it called? Oh, yes, Atlanta. Atlanta, Georgia. You've seen it, perhaps. You've been there?
Yeah, I've been there. Yeah, it's quite a bit different than it was in the book, but at the same, it's wonderful.
Well, someday, maybe, when this horrible war is over, maybe I will go there. Oh, I almost forgot. You must fill out your question. Or rather, I must fill it out.
A Red Cross form?
Yes, usual form for all prisoners of war. It simply ensures you're receiving your mail. And it says that your parents are notified you are safe. Now, your name, Ralph Cole. The rank, Staff Sergeant, and your serial number.
1-2. 127-585.
585. And your unit?
My unit? Well, is that all right to give?
Oh, yes. It's a regular part of the form. See here. Here are forms filled out by some of the other boys here. Rank, serial number, unit, date.
Okay. Just the 950th medium bombardment group.
And the date?
Of the 12th Air Force heavy bombardment base at Naples, Italy.
Naples? Italy. That's fine, Ross. And now, I think you'd better have some sleep. You're quite sure you're comfortable?
Comfortable? Look, for the past 3 weeks, I've been living in one tent with 8 other guys. That ought to give you some idea.
One tent, that surprises me. You know, I always thought the American Air Force had far better accommodations for its men than Germany.
Oh, they do, all right. It's just that we sort of moved into Naples in a hurry, and they weren't set up for us yet.
Oh, but before that, it was not so bad.
That's right. Back in Tunisia, there was only 6 to a tent.
I see. Well, that was almost luxury, wasn't it?
That was living. But this, maybe this is German.
We are making progress, Captain Reining.
So?
According to this information Sergeant Cole gave his nurse, 3 weeks ago, the 950th Medium Bombardment Group moved to the 12th Air Force Heavy Bombardment Base at Naples, Italy.
Ah.
But it's more, the accommodations were most inadequate. 9 to a tent instead of the usual 6.
Hmm.
A rather sudden move of medium bombers to a heavy bomber field. What does that suggest to you, Reining?
Well, Major, I'd say they were needed for some special purpose. Something only they could do.
Exactly. And something only they could do out of Naples. The B-99s, you know, have a limited range. Certain targets which could not be struck from North Africa could be struck from Naples.
Yes, but which targets, Major? Within medium bomber range of Naples, there must be thousands of bombing targets.
Oh, no. Not thousands. Not for low-level missions.
Low-level missions, Major?
Yeah. The B-99s are mainly used for low-level attacks. Obviously, they are planning a low-level attack from Naples. We'll see if Sergeant Mason can tell us about that. Now, your name, I see, is Alfred Mason. That's the sergeant. Your unit number? The name of your organization, Sergeant. It's a perfectly proper question.
Yes, sir. It's the 16th Bombardment Squadron.
Yeah. And your base?
Palermo, Sicily.
No doubt you will regret missing out on all the future operations of the 16th Squadron, Sergeant.
I wouldn't like to talk about that, sir.
Naturally. But you may be sure I shall advise the general strengthening of defenses in northern Italy.
Well, I don't know where you got it, sir, but...
Reduction, Sergeant. I know those C-99s of yours were built primarily for short-range missions.
That's right, sir.
And for certain types of targets, a large one?
What do you mean, large one?
Industrial target, for example.
Oh, no, Major. I'm afraid you're wrong about that, sir.
Yeah, perhaps I don't know so much about that. But I do know what a fool you are. How dare you come into this office and attempt to deceive a German officer? The 16th Bombardment Squadron, eh? You think we're so stupid we don't know you're from the 950th group?
Well,
and from Naples, Italy, that you came 3 weeks ago from Tunisia.
That's not true. You're wrong.
Don't tell me and contradict me. Everything you said is lies. We know all about the missions you're planning, all about the extra fuel tanks in your plane.
Well, we...
What a waste of time, those plans of yours. The whole Air Force is as stupid a liar as you are.
Yeah? You'll see how stupid we are. You'll find out.
Yes, I have every intention of finding out. Your group is getting set for an important mission, isn't it?
No, I didn't mean that.
You're going to tell me what they're going to bomb. What and when?
Now, look, I don't have to tell you a thing except my name and rank and serial number.
Sergeant, you know what happens when a prisoner is seen making an escape. Yeah, that's right. He's fired on. That's what your Captain Spencer is about to do, Sergeant. He's about to be shot. Shall we say, while attempting to escape.
You're lying.
You can see the Mason. It's up to you. A few words.
I won't tell you a thing, so you can go right on with your bluff. That's all it is. It's just a bluff. It's a bluff.
Come to the window and see for yourself. Look, you haven't much time. Think, Major. Think how little it takes to keep that man alive.
Stop it, stop it, will you?
Depends on you whether or not they fire. Now, those plans you're going to be making, what are they?
Well, that's it. I don't know. It was only a guess.
What? I believe it.
No, wait a minute. I meant I was only going by heart. Look, you see, right after the mission you were just on, everybody was to have a layoff. And all the planes are going to be checked over. I just figured they're getting set for something big, that's all.
How long a layoff was it supposed to be? When were the planes to be ready?
In 2 days. Tomorrow morning.
Tomorrow morning? There. What's the target?
I don't know.
Don't lie to me. You do know. What is the target?
I tell you, I don't know. You got to believe me.
All right. Captain Reading! Oh, geez.
No, you can't do that. Don't you understand? I'm telling you the truth. I swear I am.
Listening to name, rank, serial number, featuring members of the United States Army Air Forces on the Cavalcade of America. Sponsored by the DuPont Company of Wilmington, Delaware. Maker of better things for better living in two minutes. This is the story of Willy Glock, which is a German interrogation center for captured American air crew. The story of what happened when one such crew broke the don't talk rule. Our story continues. Major von Bank and Captain Rooming, German intelligence officers, discuss information revealed to them by an American sergeant.
Good work, Rooming. For a moment, even I thought it was Captain Spencer before the firing squad.
Thank you, Major. We dressed up Furlitt to act the part.
Oh? And Furlitt, I think he's a very credible actor.
Let us proceed.
Sergeant Mason gave us quite a bit to work on. Your aid is planned for tomorrow morning. Let's look at the map.
Yeah.
We will leave from here, from Naples. They'll go, safe to say, the B-99 can't penetrate further than this area. 800 miles from their base. And that's even with the extra fuel tanks they propose to use.
Extra fuel tanks. How did you learn about those, Major?
Mason told me. Or the expression did. I made a stab and it struck. There was another stab that worked. I suggested that his group was planning only short-range missions, and he assured me I had made a remarkable discovery. A very poor liar, that boy. So, a long-range mission. We concentrate on industrial targets.
Did you?
Yeah. When I suggested just that, the good sergeant assured me I was definitely wrong. Another one of his stupid lies. Cities, then. Sofia, Bucharest, Belgrade, Vienna, and Munich. The next step is to learn which one of these is the target. One more clue is all we need.
One clue. Yes.
I wonder if something occurred to you, Captain O'Reilly.
When I talked to Lieutenant Williams, he said something about his flight commander. What was his name? Johnson.
Yes.
He told me Johnson was given a leave just 2 days ago. It may mean nothing.
The flight commander given leave? For what reason?
Lieutenant Williams did not know. He used to think it was routine.
Routine? To give a key man a leave just before an important raid? I think not. I think this is our mission crew. Really, I'm sure of it. We must find out why Johnson was taken off. We must find out tonight.
And Captain Spencer is our man, I think. He's commander of this crew, and therefore would know more about the flight commander.
Yes. And whether he likes it or not, Captain Spencer will talk tonight.
Here we are, Captain Spencer. We'll dine with some of our German pilots. They serve the best food in Dulacroo.
Anything you say, Captain Rooney?
Yeah. This is a mess room.
Oh, excuse me, gentlemen. Excuse me. We have a guest. This is Captain Spencer.
Herman Goldie, Angold Mark, Hans von Crawley.
Captain Spencer, happy to meet you, sir. Sit down.
And why?
Thank you, Lieutenant. You are commander of a B-99, I understand, Captain Spencer.
That's right.
Ah, then you are a dangerous man.
To your health, Captain.
And to yours. You know, just as you entered, the commander here was discussing his group's plan to bomb your ammunition dump near Rome. He was telling us, Captain Glenning, about his squadron leader who planned the mission.
The best player in our organization, I might add.
Yeah. But quite suddenly this morning, just one day before the mission, the man was released of his command.
So? What was the explanation?
None at all. It is very strange.
Oh, you will learn, I am sure, that the man became ill. It is as simple as that.
No, but it is not, my friend. He left for Berlin for a holiday, as I understand it. One does not have a holiday when one is too ill to fly. Isn't that right, Captain Spencer?
He wouldn't have to be very ill. I know of a case quite similar to this.
First, the squadron leader seemed perfectly well.
Yes, but a man can have quite a good time, Commander, if all he has is a cold in the head.
Cold in the head? Cold in... Yes. Yes, I suppose you're right. By the way, there's a phone call I have to make here. You'll excuse me, Captain Spencer.
But,
gentlemen, I'll be right back.
Yeah, and give the captain some more wine, Lieutenant Friday. He deserves it.
Well, what do you make of it, Major von Bent? Johnson was taken off because he had a cold in his head.
Of course, it doesn't have to be too much of a cold to keep a man out of an oxygen mask. That means high altitude flying.
Yes, but we know that this mission is to be low level bombing.
Mm-hmm. But sometimes even low level missions have to climb up stairs.
Mountains.
Exactly, mountains. A low level bombing mission, but to get to their objective, they must cross some 50 good sized mountains. Using oxygen masks. Impossible for a man suffering from a cold. Shall we look at the map?
Yeah. No mountains on route to Belgrade, Major.
Nor there, on the way to Budapest.
But Munich?
Munich? Yeah. That is something else. For in order to come in low over the Goering synthetic oil refinery, one must first fly high. Quite high above the Austrian Alps. So, Munich it is.
Munich. Tomorrow morning.
And we shall be ready for them, reading. Thanks to our good friend, Captain Spencer.
And the next night, at the operations office of the American Air Base in Naples, weary crew members, having returned from the Munich raid, report to an American intelligence officer.
Go ahead, Lieutenant.
They met us about an hour out of Munich. Messerschmitt, all over the place. About eight of them jumped Maxwell and Thomas. We saw them go down burning. Like that all the way to the target. They're getting smaller and smaller. Smith got it. Wilkerson, Marion, Dale and Montgomery and Reynolds. I don't know how many others.
Well, there was a tip-off. It had to be a tip-off.
Oh, how could there be? There wasn't anybody from this outfit who could reach the Jerrys who could talk to him.
Well, we lost Spencer's crew to the Jerrys just the other day. There
wasn't a better bunch of guys anywhere than Spencer's crew. Al Mason wouldn't give any information if his life depended on it. And Ralph Cole, well, he'd cut his right arm off for you. That goes to Joe Williams and Jimmy Spencer. You think they'd talk to you nuts? What could they talk about? If we didn't know where we were going or when or how until this morning, how could they have known it 3 days ago?
You don't have to know where or when or how to tell the enemy all he needs to know. You don't even have to be a traitor. You might as well be. All you need do is relax for one instant. All you need do is talk. Give anything but your name, your rank, your serial number. What happened to Spencer's crew may happen to any pilot, to any crew, tomorrow, or next week, or next month. And if it does, remember this. Even though you're a prisoner of war, you're still an American soldier. And you, merely by remaining silent, may be playing a greater part in this war than you ever played before. Your name, your rank, your serial number, nothing more. Name, your rank, your serial number. That's the moral of our story and the credo of every fighting man in every branch of service. Don't talk. Don't talk. Don't talk.
Thanks to you, Lieutenant William Holden, Private Kent Smith, Sergeant James C.A., John Beale, Pat McVeigh, Charles Cannon, and Corporal Arthur Kennedy, and all the cast and tonight's DuPont Cavalcade. Our Cavalcade play tonight was taken from an Army Air Force's training film. Here's a key story about a Navy training film. A drugstore manager, now in the Navy, was given a job of running a motion picture machine. One of the training pictures he had to show taught men how to aim and fire a rifle. While Jones, we'll call him Jones, was careful really to study the picture each time he ran it in the machine. Why? Because his company was made up of men from Kentucky and Tennessee, squirrel hunters, most of them, and they could drive a pack at 50 yards with a rifle. But Jones, the drugstore manager, had never gone hunting, never shot a gun in his life. The other men kidded him about the bad showing he was going to make on the target range. Well, the day came. Out they marched to the range, Jones and the squirrel hunters. And what happened? Jones, who had learned to shoot by running a movie, scored third high out of the entire company. That's how good these training films can be. And here's Jane Whitman to tell you more about them.
The Navy alone now sends from 30 to 60,000 prints of training films each month to training centers, ships at sea, and advanced bases. Sailors can learn more about a complicated subject, like fire control, from a 15-minute movie than they can from a 2-hour lecture, the Navy finds. As for the Army, well, 36 green men in the Engineer Corps, after seeing a training film just once, went out and built a timber trestle bridge so strong that tanks could run over it. Men who had never built a bridge in their lives. These training films that have done such a wonderful job in wartime are going to accomplish a great deal for education after the war. In a trade school, a boy will be able to learn the elementary facts about a diesel engine, say, or chemistry, in an unbelievably short time. Girls in business college will learn to take notes and do typing under actual business conditions, with messengers coming and going on the screen, telephones ringing, and all the hubbub of a busy office around them. From kindergarten through college, students will be able to learn more easily and more quickly under the best and latest teaching methods, training films. And many educational pictures in peacetime, like those in wartime, will be photographed on DuPont motion picture film. One of the DuPont company's better things for a better living through chemistry. And now, Walter Houston.
Next week, the Cavalcade of America will bring you Ida Lupino, a thrilling radio dramatization of Irving Stone's bestseller, Immortal Wife. Story of Jesse Benton Fremont, wife of an Army explorer who later became a presidential candidate and a Civil War general. Listen next Monday to Immortal Wife with Ida Lupino on the Cavalcade of America. This is Walter Houston saying thank you and good evening.
Tonight's Cavalcade play was adapted for radio by Ben Kagan from the Army Air Force's training film, Resisting Enemy Interrogation, written by Technical Sergeant Harold Medford. The music was composed and conducted by Robert Armbrister. This is Jane Whitman sending you best wishes from Cavalcade sponsor, E.I. DuPont, in the Moores and Company of Wilmington, Delaware.
Broadcasting Company.